Good afternoon. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry, it was. Thank you for coming this evening to this afternoon, the Foreign Correspondent Club of Japan. We have very interesting event today. It's mixed with cartoon and politics. And our guest speaker is, according to our announcement, he has been conservative in the Japanese politics. And it seems he changed his direction, if we could say that, to become kind of critical of the Abe government in terms of the controversial laws about security that will allow Japan to participate in wars, according to some criticism, outside the borders, which is a violation of the constitution, as what the opposition party says. So we will have about 20 minutes, questions and answers, and that will be followed by, we have 20 minutes of speech, including the translation, followed by about 40 minutes and maybe extended a little bit of questions and answer. And we could also, I'm not sure if you could show his cartoons, but he made very nice signature on our guest book in the club. He signed with a very nice cartoon. I hope the members will see it later on. Thank you for coming today. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our guest, Mr. Yoshinori Kobayashi. Thank you.
皆さんこんにちは、小林義則です。
So, thank you very much. Hello, I am 吉野小林。私
は日本語を世界の公用語にしたいと思っておりますので、英語は喋りませんので、一流の通訳の方にお任せします。
So I would like to make it very clear from the beginning. I am intent on making Japanese the official language of the world. So I have absolutely no intention of speaking Japanese. I'm speaking English today. Excuse me.
保守派の中で日本の保守派の中で小林義則が今回の安保法制で、方向転換したというのは実は間違っておりまして、私は保守というのは基本的に日本のアイデンティティを保守しなければならないというふうに思っております。
I would like to make a comment about the way that I was introduced and the way that I was presented in the announcement for today's press conference. It seems to be that people think that I am belonging to the conservative camp, but because of the current debates about security legislation, that I have sort of changed my direction. I haven't changed my direction. I believe that a conservative is basically a person who believes in conserving Japan's identity.
だから基本的に憲法を改正して、日本の自衛隊は軍隊にするべきだと思っております。
So I feel very strongly that fundamentally the Japanese constitution should be revised and the Japanese self-defense forces should be changed and become a Japanese military or army force.
ところが日本の保守派って言われている人たちっていうのはほとんど全てアメリカについていくことを保守しているわけです。
However, I believe that my ideas differ fundamentally from the ideas of most other people who, in Japan who consider themselves conservatives. They don't think about conserving Japan's identity. They think about conserving their relationship with the United States, basically following the United States.
だから、かつてイラク戦争が始まったときに、このイラク戦争は間違っている。侵略戦争だ、大量破壊兵器はないということを主張したのは、まあ、保守派の中では、わしともう一人、西部進むっていう男がいるんですけれども、この二人ぐらいしかいませんでした。あとは全部アメリカについていけ、イラク戦争を支持するっていう話でした。
Just to give you an example of what I'm saying, when the Iraq war broke out some years ago, there was positive proof, in my opinion, that this was a war of aggression, that in fact there were no weapons of mass destruction. However, among all of the people who consider themselves or call themselves the conservatives in Japan, I think it was only myself and one other person, a man named Susumu Nishibe, who asserted that this was a wrong war, a mistaken war, and we should not be involved. However, all of the other people, the people who call themselves conservatives, supported the United States.And followed the United States into the war.
イラク戦争を に反対したために私は保守派から徹底的にバッシングを受けました。
Because I was so very much against Japan's joining the Iraq war, I was bashed very clearly and strongly by the conservative side.
そして今、イラク戦争は間違いなく侵略戦争だったということがもう明確になりました。これはアメリカでもイギリスでもそういう総括はされているはずです。
However, now the time has passed. There is now definitive proof and a widespread understanding that the Iraq war was a mistaken war, that it was a war of aggression. This is the common understanding in the United States and the United Kingdom.
ところが日本の保守派はこのイラク戦争に関して間違っていたということを認めません。安倍首相も認めません。
However, the Japanese conservatives still refuse to acknowledge that participating in the Iraq war was a mistake. They do not acknowledge that it was a mistaken policy, and Prime Minister Abe himself still has not acknowledged that it was a mistake.
安倍首相、自民党、これらはアメリカがまた次の侵略戦争を始めたときについていかなければいけないからです。
Why do these people, Prime Minister Abe and the LDP, why do these people refuse to acknowledge that the Iraq war was a war of aggression, that it was a mistake? That is because they know that in the future, the United States may embark on another war of aggression. And when it does so, they know that they must follow in the footsteps of the United States.
日本人が独自の判断ができるのならば、この戦争は防衛戦争としてやらなければいけない。だがこの戦争は侵略戦争だからダメだとはっきり言えなければいけません。
In other words, if the Japanese people truly have the ability and the power to make their own individual judgments, they could say, they could discern between different potential wars and say, yes, this is definitely a war of defense and we can do take action. And this, however, is another war of aggression and we cannot take part.
だから憲法改正の理念そのものがわしと他のアメリカについていくだけの保守の人々とは違っています。
So when we talk about constitutional revision, the ideas that I have about this concept and the ideas that other people who say that they are conservatives but who only believe in following the United States are fundamental concepts differ.
日本は今後も侵略戦争はやりません。過去侵略戦争やったことはある。だがもう侵略戦争はやりません。専守防衛に徹するべきです。
In other words, Japan should never again engage in a war of aggression. It has in the past engaged in wars of aggression, but never again. In other words, Japan should be very, very clear. Japan should only engage in individual self-defense.
アメリカは今後も必ず侵略戦争をやります。ベトナム戦争しかり、アフガン、イラク。侵略戦争、しかもなおかつ世界を破壊しておいて、それでビルドしません。スクラップ&ビルドのビルドの方ができません。必ず撤退します。
It is, there's no question in my mind that the United States will eventually embark on another war of aggression in the future. If we look back at history, we see the Vietnam War, Afghanistan War, the war in Iraq, they were all wars of aggression. And not only that, when the United States engages in these wars, they basically destroy the countries in which they wage war. But there is a concept of scrap and build. Well, they do very well in the scrapping part, but they do not do well in the building part. In other words, they destroy these nations.But they do not rebuild them, reconstruct them.
だから日本というのはかつての反省をするのならばね、侵略戦争を絶対にしない。これは憲法改正しても条文の中に入れなければいけません。それで日本は専守防衛に徹する。でアメリカっていうのはアメリカとは個々に特別法的なものをこう結んでいく。というやり方で安全保障の体系を組み立てなければいけないと思っています。
So Japan, if it truly feels remorse for what it has done in the past, it should never again engage in a war of aggression. Even if there is going to be constitutional revision in the future, that concept that Japan should never engage in wars of aggression should be put into the body of the Constitution, into the actual wording and phrasing of the Constitution. In regard to the relationship with the United States, there can be special laws, extraordinary laws, special measures laws that can be implemented for each special individual case. This is the kind of security overall system that we must put into place.
日本の保守派が今言っているのは尖閣諸島の問題で、ガス田開発、日中中間線のガス田開発の問題、それとあとスプラトリー諸島、これが中国がの覇権が押し寄せてきてるから、これが怖い、これが怖いから集団的自衛権が必要だっていう論理の組み立て方になってます。
What the Japanese conservatives are now saying, are the people that call themselves conservatives are now saying, is that we see the problem of China's hegemonistic ambitions. In other words, we see the problems around the Senkaku Islands. We see they're building gas oil rigs on the demarcation line between Japanese and Chinese territorial waters. We see what they're doing around the Spratly Islands. Because of all of these movements by China and their maritime expansions, we're frightened, we're worried, and that is why we need to be able to exercise the right to collective self-defense. That is their logic.
尖閣諸島のが危ないというのならば、だったら尖閣諸島に日本の軍港を作ればいい。それでガス田開発しているものと対決すればいい。だが、おそらくこの尖閣諸島に例えばじゃあ軍港を作るって言ったら、それを反対するのはアメリカでしょ。
If it is true, as I said, that Japanese people are worried about Chinese interests around the Senkaku Islands, well then the proper way to deal with this situation is for Japanese to build a military port on the Senkaku Islands. In that way, they would be able to better deal with the issue of the drilling for gas in Chinese and Japanese territorial waters. However, in regard to the suggestion that I made, or this proposition I made of building a Japanese military port, I think it would be the United States that would immediately object.
アメリカは絶対に中国とは戦争しません。そうなると日本は完全に利用されるだけ。それこそその将来には中東の戦争に出ていかなければいけなくなるでしょう。
In other words, the United States would never agree to a military port being built around there because U.S. never wants to find itself embroiled in a war with China. It will never want to battle China. So what will happen? What will happen is that eventually Japan will find itself being used more and more by the United States. Eventually there will come a day when Japanese forces will be forced to fight in the Middle East with the United States.
アラブの人たちというのは日本が日露戦争を戦ったことに対して敬意を表してくれています。アラブの人たちを敵にしてはなりません。日本の
The people of the Arab world, they understand Japan's long history. They know that Japan beat or defeated Russia in the Russo-Japanese War, and they respect the Japanese people for having done so. We must never, we the Japanese people must never make enemies of the Arab people
そこでもう一つ問題点があります。憲法の問題です。この、私は憲法9条を守れということは言いません。ただ、立憲主義は守らなければならない。
There's also another problem that is very dear to my heart, which is about the Constitution of Japan. I'm not one that says we must defend Article 9 at all costs. That's not what I'm saying, but I believe that we must defend at all costs constitutionalism.
立憲主義というのは国民が権力を縛るためのものです。
What is constitutionalism after all? It is the only way in which the people, the citizens, will be able to bind or control or put a check on the authority of or the power of the government. In other words, it is the only way to keep them from running amok.
戦前日本は軍部が暴走しました。軍部を抑える、軍部という権力を抑える規律が明治憲法の中になかった。
In other words, in pre-war Japan, we saw that the military authorities basically had gone run was running amok, in, and that they were completely out of control. And in other words, the powers that controlled the military, there was nothing in the Meiji Constitution, which was the pre-war constitution. There was no system within the Meiji Constitution that could put a check, that allowed the people to put a check or a hold on the military.
戦後の日本国憲法はアメリカから押し付けられたものであるにせよシビリアンコントロールあります。だからそのシビリアンコントロールのシビリアンの方が暴走するとこれはどうにもなりません。
In regard to the post-war Japanese constitution, there is criticism that it was a constitution that was created by the United States and basically forced upon the Japanese people. Even if that is so, there is one very good aspect to it, which is that there is a civilian control very clearly delineated in the constitution. The civilian control can control the military part. However, if this civilian control part goes out of control, then the country is lost.
さてここで立憲主義と中国の脅威、この2つを天秤にかけたときに、今現在この憲法の方を解釈改憲で立憲主義を崩壊させなければいけないほどこの中国の脅威は迫っているでしょうか。
So right now the question that is facing us is that we have two issues. One is the idea of constitutionalism and how far we are going to go in preserving constitutionalism. On the other side of the scale, we have the growing threat of China. When you think about these two issues, is the growing threat of China so great, so frightening that we must endanger constitutionalism? In other words, that we must try to do something such as a reinterpreting the constitution and basically destroying constitutionalism in the process in order to deal with this threat of China. Is the threat of China so great as to do that?
憲法改正するには1年か2年あれば足りる。この1年か2年の間に中国が日本を侵略してくるでしょうか。
I believe that in order to achieve constitutional revision, it would only take one or two years. During that one or two years, do you truly think that China will invade or wage a war of aggression against Japan?
真正面から憲法改正を国民に問えばいいのです。これをやらない。やらないのはなぜか、アメリカについていくことだけが最大の目的だからです。安倍政権の。
In other words, what I believe is necessary is for the government to be frank and honest and present the idea of constitutional revision to the people of Japan. Why don't they do that? The reason is the only thing that is foremost in the minds of the people in Prime Minister Abe's administration is that they want to be able to stick to the United States, to follow the United States. That is their ultimate goal.
今回の安倍政権の解釈改憲のやり方で国民はつくづく警戒してしまいました。このままでいくと憲法改正そのものを発議しても国民投票で勝てません。
The fact that Prime Minister Abe chose to, a specific way to deal with the situation, in other words, he tried to basically avoid the issue of constitutional revision by reinterpreting or presenting a new interpretation of the Constitution. This method that he took has put the people of Japan on high alert. They've become very cautious about him. They've become very wary of him. Because he has done this, if at this point in time the government were to present a motion to the public and ask them to vote on this idea of constitutional revision, they would probably say no.
この犠牲になるのは自衛隊です。自衛隊というのはポジティブリストでしか戦えません。普通軍隊というのは国際法だけを守ればいい。だからネガティブリストなんです。
And what will be the victims? Who will be the victims of all of this, all of these proceedings? It will be the self-defense forces. In other words, they will be exposed to what I call a positive list. Generally, military forces only work according to the laws of international laws. However, in this case, they will be exposed to a positive list rather than a negative list.
これならやってもいい、これならやってもいい、これならやってもいいっていうポジティブリストばっかりで縛られた自衛隊が 国際法に縛られていること以外だったら何でもやれるという米軍と一体になっていくというのは非常に危険です。
What I mean by this is that what is going to be presented to the self-defense forces is a list of things that they can do. They can do this, they can do that, they can do this, they can do that. It is a list that seems on the face of it to be very positive and very freeing, but it is in many ways something that very much ties them down. What they can do, they almost really have to do. And that puts them in a very negative position compared to the U.S. forces who are bound only by the list of things that they cannot do under international law.
自衛隊には軍法会議もありません。軍隊だったら軍法会議がなければいけない。軍法会議がないということはどうなるかといったら、戦場で起こったことに対処して、もし人を殺めたら、国内法で裁かれる。殺人罪として刑務所に入らなければいけない。
Just to give you an example of the kinds of things that I'm saying, for example, the self-defense forces do not have military courts, military tribunals. If they were a proper military force, they would have military courts. What does this mean exactly? It means that if the self-defense forces are involved in battle and someone dies, then they would not be tried according to a soldier's court, but they would be tried in their home countries in the regular court system. They could be tried for murder.
自衛隊員を守るため、そして日本という国が二度と侵略戦争に巻き込まれないため、安保法制には反対しなければいけないという理論なのです。
In other words, what I'm basically saying, and the point of all of my arguments is that in order to protect the members of the self-defense forces, in order to ensure that Japan never again becomes embroiled in wars of aggression, we must be against this current security legislation bills.
アメリカは今はイラク戦争で懲りてるから今後10年の間に軍縮していって、でその軍縮した部分を日本の戦力で賄おうと補填しようとしてるわけです。
As you know, the United States now is in a state of being quite exhausted from experiences in the Iraq War. They're very tired. They've used up a great deal of money. And as a result, over the next 10 years, they intend to shrink their military budget. As a result, in order to make up for this shrinking budget, they want Japan's fighting power to sort of compensate or to complement the United States.
アメリカという国は必ずまた戦争しますよ。これ軍産複合体の問題もあって、で古くなった兵器は在庫一掃セールをしなければいけない。だから必ず戦争します。こんな危険な国はないんですよ。
The United States is a nation that willinevitably, without any kind of doubt, stage again a war of aggression. The reasons are complex, and one reason is that there is this very huge military-industrial complex that is strong in the United States, and eventually they're going to have to get rid of all of their old weapons so that they can start rebuilding new ones. In other words, they must wage war.
したがって、わしが言っている安保法制反対っていうのは陳腐な平和主義者とは違うんです。
So I would like to make it very, very clear. When I say that I am very much against the current security legislation being debated, I am not speaking from the same point of view as the pacifists that we see who I do not regard very highly.
わしはフランスとかドイツが羨ましいですよ。アメリカのイラク戦争の時に堂々と反対ができる。で、フランスなんかずいぶんアメリカからバッシングされてましたよね。けれども間違ってなかった、正しかったわけですよ。日本がそのように行動できるかどうかっていうのは、今の安倍首相がイラク戦争は間違っていたということを認めるっていうことから始めるしかないんです。
I'm very, very envious of other nations in the world. For example, France and Germany. When they were asked to join in the Iraq War, they very boldly and clearly and frankly came out and said that they were against the war. In particular, France was very much bashed by the United States for taking such a position. However, in the end, it was proved that their position was correct. Could Japan ever behave in that way? In other words, make their own decisions? If Japan is ever to be able to behave in that way, the first step would be for Prime Minister Abe to acknowledge publicly that it was a mistake for Japan to join that war.
本来日本で欲しいって言うのなら、みんなわしのような考え方しなきゃおかしいんです。ただひたすらアメリカについていけっていうやつがどこが保守なんですか？
When we talk about conservatives in Japan, inherent in that idea of conservatism is the belief that the kinds of beliefs that I've just been espousing. In other words, the people who label themselves as conservatives, when you think about what they're doing, their fundamental real belief and only belief is that they simply want to follow the United States. How can you regard these people as being true conservatives?
こういうことをわしのような漫画家が言ってるってこと自体がもう世の中すべてギャグですよ。
The fact that I, who am just a comic artist or a cartoonist, have to be making these kinds of political statements, it shows you that the absurdity of the situation in Japan right now.
もう私が言いたいことの核心は、このくらいです。あとは質問を受けます。
So this goes to the heart of what I wanted to say today. So from now on, I'd like to respond to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We got the message very clearly. And you'd like to open the floor for questions and answers. Please raise your hand and proceed to the front. Richard?
Richard Lloyd Parry of The Times. What do you think Prime Minister Abe should say to mark the 70th anniversary of the end of the war?
イギリスのタイムズ紙でございます。今回安倍首相が70年談話を出すということになっているのでございますが、彼はその談話で何を言うべきだと思いますでしょうか。
そうだな。まず戦争っていうのはね、相手があってやることなんですよ。アメリカの勝者の戦争観に合わせる必要はない。これはアメリカは常に自分の国が正義、戦う方を悪っていうふうに規定して戦います。それで戦争が終わった後には相手の国を全て悪にするっていうやり方にしますね。で、これは間違ってます。もし戦争を裁く裁判を作るとすると、被告席にアメリカの方も座らなければいけません。アメリカの戦争犯罪もきちんと裁かなければいけない。原爆とかね、そうやらないと当然だから日本の悪も裁いていいんですよ。そういう視点から戦後70年の談話が語ることができるのかどうか、完全にアメリカの戦争史観に染まったような談話だったら、わしは批判します。
I believe that when one wages war, there always has to be another party, the opposing party against which you are waging war. There is no reason for a nation, for example, in our case, Japan, to simply stand on the side of previously victorious countries and simply agree to the positions that they take. What I'm trying to say is that the United States, in all of the wars that it has fought, has always taken the same position. It is always in the right. It is always fighting the cause of justice. And it is the other party, the enemy, that is evil. And after the war ends, everything associated with that country is fundamentally evil. And I believe that approach to war is fundamentally wrong. If we can have a true international war crimes court, then I think from time to time in the defendant's seat, the United States should sometimes always should also sometimes sit. In other words, in wars, everyone commits crimes. So the United States should sit in the defendant's seat to pay or to be judged for its war crimes. For example, for dropping the atomic bomb, as an example. Of course, I think that Japan should also be sitting in the defendant's seat for the war crimes that it commits. But the point of, I am trying to get across is that everyone should be treated fairly, equally. But this point of view that I've just expressed, will Prime Minister Abe be able to include this kind of thinking in his 70th year war statement? I don't know. In other words, if it is going to be a statement that basically only reflects the goals and thoughts of the United States, then I will be very critical of it.
ただし、わしの考えではですね、中国に入っていったこと、日本軍が、これは、まあ、侵略的な要素が強いというふうに言わざるを得ません。韓国、満州までは、ある意味その当時、帝国主義の時代の国際法にはかなってます。
According to my thinking, I believe that when the Japanese military invaded or entered China, I think that entering of China did have strong elements of aggressive wars. In other words, there were wars of aggression elements or aspects to that entering of China. In regard to Japan's role in what is now South Korea or into Manchuria, at that time, this was an era of empires, and for the international laws of that time, Japan was still behaving or acting properly within the framework of international laws of empires at that time.
ただし、韓国を日本に併合したこと、これは国際法にかなっていて、どこの国も賛成したんですね。けれども、それでも、やはり隣の文化的にも非常に交流のある国を植民地的な位置に置いたってことは、彼らの中にコンプレックスを育ててしまう。これは政策としてはやっぱり失敗だったなと私は思ってます。
But as I mentioned, there, the Japan at that time was following international law in annexing South Korea, what is now South Korea. At that time, that action, the Korean Peninsula, at that time, that might have been acceptable under international law, and other countries in the world basically approved this annexation. When we consider that this was, however, a people that were very, very close, similar to Japan, and Japanese culturally, the fact that Japan treated them as a colony was something that was a mistake. What I mean by this is that I think by treating such very, very similar people as a colony, as members of a colony, created a feeling of inferiority or a complex inside their personalities. So what I'm saying is that as a national policy, the annexation of the Korean Peninsula was a mistake.
欧米は植民地を作るときに間接統治でした。自分の国からずいぶん遠く離れたところを植民地にして間接統治するわけです。自分が直接統治じゃない。ところが日本はすぐ隣の国を直接統治してしまった。これは本当に大きな失敗だったなと思っています。
In other words, this was a time of empires of colonization. However, the great powers of the West did their colonization in a very, very different manner. They colonized countries that were very, very geographically distant far from them. And although they were colonies, they were not governed directly, but they were, it was a kind of indirect governance or control of these colonies. Japan, however, as he said, made a mistake in they basically colonized their next door neighbor. And that, and they also conducted direct governance or control, direct rule over the of these countries, and I think that was a mistake.
そういう意味では、韓国の人たちにも申し訳なかったなという気持ちが日本人の中にあっていい。
In that sense, I believe that there should be a feeling within the Japanese people that to the people of the Korean Peninsula, to what is now South Korea, I think there should be a feeling that we feel very bad, and we feel the Japanese word is moshiwakinai, which is a little difficult to translate into English, but that we are full of remorse and sorrow and regret.
こういう分析をきちんとした上でどのようにそれを表現するかっていうのが問題なんですけれども、とても今の安倍政権ではそういう思考回路は難しい。
In other words, all of these things that have happened in the past and that are continuing in the present day need to be carefully and deeply analyzed and fully understood. And then once a conclusion is reached, the ideas need to be worked out as to how best to express these feelings and these concepts and these ideas. Having said this, however, I believe that the current administration under Mr. Abe is incapable. They do not have the capacity to be able to think through these difficult processes, mental processes.
まあ、そのくらいですね。
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Joël Lejean from RTL France Broadcasting. France Radio-Télévision, tout court, this. You said, if I want to understand well, if I can ask you to clarify, you want a constitution revision directly. Yeah? You don't like the process going on these days of reinterpretation. You prefer a new constitution. So just to ask you, you don't go against the fact that Japanese army could be sent abroad on war operations.Is that correct?
フランスの RTL 放送のものでございます。ちょっと一つだけ確認したいんでございますが、憲法改正を直接したいの、実現したいというふうにお考えでございます。今のやり方、今のその解釈を変更するということに関しては反対であるんですけど、その憲法を改正するのには賛成ということでございます。で、新しく改正された憲法によって、日本の、軍人あるいは自衛隊の方たちが海外で、戦いに行けるということに関しては反対ではないということでしょうか。ちょっと確認したかったんですが、
侵略戦争はダメだって言ってるんです。アメリカについてついていって侵略戦争に巻き込まれることはダメだって言ってるんです。自衛のための戦争はやりますよ。だから北朝鮮が暴発した場合はこれはやらなければいけません。
What I'm saying is that I do not believe that Japan should ever become embroiled in a war of aggression. It should not simply follow the United States and find itself being caught up in a war of aggression. I believe that it is all right and proper for Japan to be able to engage in war if it must defend itself. In other words, a self-defense war. For example, if, North Korea were to become in a situation that was, where it was out of control, then Japan might have to step up and defend itself.
麻生太郎さんがですね、この憲法を、憲法改正そのものをどうも諦めたような雰囲気があって、それでワイマール憲法を形骸化させるっていう手もあるとかっていうふうに麻生太郎が言いましたよね。私はあの時すごく警戒したんですよ。あ、やる気だなと。つまりナチスドイツはワイマール憲法を形骸化してしまって、全権委任法を作って独裁に持っていってしまった。このやり方をやるつもりだなと。ちょっとそこまで注意してください。
I think you may remember that Mr. Aso made a comment that was criticized quite severely at the time. He said he seemed to have given up on the idea of eventually being able to realize constitutional revision. So he made a comment that another way to get around this problem might be to learn the technique of the National Socialist Party in Germany, the Nazis. In other words, they basically had the Weimar Republic and they had a constitution, but they basicallygot around it by making the constitution basically ineffective, making it simply a shell of its former self. And when I heard his comments, I thought, Mr. Assel was very, very serious about trying to do something like that. In other words, he really is serious about trying to learn from the Nazis. What the Nazis did, basically, was they passed a law that allowed them to have all power, authority passed over to them. And as a result, a dictatorship was born. I believe that this is what some people in government are trying to do.
カール・シュミットっていう法学者がですね、彼の著述の中で、主権者とは例外状況において決断を下すものであるっていうふうに書いてるんですよ。
Many of you may know the very important legal academic scholar, Mr. Carl Schmitt. He wrote a book, and there's a very famous phrase when he describes what a sovereign or the head of a state or head of a country is. He said basically a sovereign is one who makes a decision or passes a judgment when there is an exceptional situation, exceptional case.
実際これがナチスドイツがうまくこれをこの学説を利用して独裁に持っていくんですけれどもね。
And it's the Nazi government that basically took his words and his ideas and used it for their benefit. They used this idea that there was an exceptional case and therefore the leaders had to make a decision and take control and they eventually created a dictatorship.
国民主権というふうに言うけれども、本当の主権者というのは法の外にある状況。例外状況の時に誰が決断を下すかっていうところにあると、これが本当の主権だっていうふうにカール・シュミットは言うんですね。
In other words, what is Mr. Carl Schmitt actually was he trying to say? Of course, in our constitution, it says that sovereignty lies with the people. Having said this, however, when there is an exceptional case, an extraordinary situation, who really possesses a sovereignty or control over the nation. He is saying that in exceptional cases and extraordinary situations, it is the people, the true sovereign are the people or is the person who can make decisions that go beyond or outside of the normal rule of law.
今が果たしてその例外状況なのかっていうことなんですね。だから先ほど言ったように中国が明日にも攻めてくるっていう例外状況ならば今の憲法っていうものは役に立ちませんから、その時は本物の主権者たる統治者が、統治者が自由な解釈でもうやっても仕方がないわけですよ。けれども今そういう例外状況ではないっていうことなんです。
In other words, the question that I am posing to you is that are we in an exceptional situation now? Are we truly in an extraordinary situation now? Is it that we are in such a threatened situation that China might attack us today or tomorrow? If that is the case, then obviously the Constitution as it stands would be a totally ineffective tool, and the true sovereign would be the people who are actually ruling the nation. They would be able to make a decision and do whatever interpretation of the Constitution that they wish and make whatever decisions that they feel are necessary. And in that kind of an exceptional, extraordinary situation, that kind of decision is unavoidable.
ナチスドイツを真似て法を形骸化させようというような権力は最大限に警戒しなければいけません。
However, this idea of following the footsteps of Nazi Germany, of learning their lessons, of taking the constitution that exists and making it basically ineffective, leaving it only a shell of its former self, the idea of trying to learn and copy what the Nazi administration in Germany did, anyone who espouses such ideas should be treated with tremendous caution.
とりあえずそんなところで。
Yes.He's from Germany, so maybe.
あの、カール・シュミットの話が出ましたので、私はドイツ出身でございますのでということでございます。
So, Siegfried Nittel, from Germany, but writing for Austrian newspaper, Der Standard. I want to ask you about position to the United States. You're very critical about the United States.So, and should be Japan more independent from the United States? And what does it mean for a security treaty? What does it mean for American troops stationed in Japan?
ドイツ出身でございますが、今そのオーストリアの新聞、歴史を書いております。で、私はあの、日米関係について伺いたいと思うんでございます。まあ、かなりあの、米国に対して批判的なコメントをいろいろされているような感じがするんでございますが、やはりあの日本はもうちょっとその米国への依存度を、まあ、あの下げるべきだと思って、もっとインディペンデント、もっと、独立した方がいいというふうに思うんでございますでしょうか。もしそうであれば、では日本のその、安全保障体制はどうあるべきだと思いますでしょうか。そしてまた今日本にあのおります多くのその米軍をどうお考えるどうすべきいいと思いますでしょうか。
沖縄に米軍基地が異様なほど集中しています。でこの辺野古移設っていうのをどう解決すればいいのかっていうふうに言ったときに、まず基本的に自分の国土にですよ、他国の軍事基地が置いてあって、しかもなおかつそこに思いやり予算とかっていってお金をどんどんつけていく、ちょっとそういう国っていうのはどこなの、日本とクウェートと韓国ぐらいかな。他のところは米軍基地あるけれども、その土地の主権はその国の人間が持ってるでしょう。で日本は治外法権があって、米兵がレイプを、日本の女性レイプしたときには米軍基地にとにかく逃げ込めばいい。そうすると逃げられるわけですよ。これは完全な不平等条約ですから、この状況を何とかしなければいけない。基本的にはそりゃ米軍基地には出てってもらって、日本の自衛隊を軍隊にして自国は自国の軍隊で守る。こういうと大概経済的に不可能だとかって言い始めるんですよね。けど一国の独立っていうのはお金の問題ですかね。お金がないから独立したくない、お金がかかるから独立したくない、こんなバカな国じゃどうしようもないですよ。
Obviously, the concentration of U.S. bases in Okinawa is extraordinary. It is a very, very unusual and difficult situation. And we are faced with, of course, the Hinoko issue, which should be done about moving the base facilities to Hinoko. I think when we think about trying to resolve these issues, I think fundamentally we must think about what these bases are all about. In other words, fundamentally, it's a very strange concept to be having in your own land, on your own country's territory, bases and troops from another country stationed there. That in itself is not terribly unusual, but on top of that, we add something called omoyari yosan, which is translated as host nation support. And we spend an extraordinary amount of money to support the U.S. military bases and the troops there. Very few countries in the world have this kind of system. I think it's Japan and perhaps Kuwait and perhaps South Korea. Other nations do have U.S. bases on their territories, but the land belonging to the bases, they have the nation has the sovereign right to those that land. In Japan, however, there is this idea of extraterritoriality. In other words, if a U.S. soldier comes out into the city and rapes a Japanese woman, if that soldier is able to escape back into the U.S. base, he is not prosecutable under Japanese law because that is considered no longer Japanese territory. This is an example of the unequal treaties of the past, and this is obviously a situation that must be changed and corrected. I think the only way to do this is to have the U.S. bases, the troops remove themselves, and the self-defense forces establish bases in Japan, and the self-defense forces defend its own country, become a military and defend its own country. Whenever I start to espouse these kinds of ideas, many people say that financially, economically, this is just simply not possible. But I would like to counter that by saying, when I talk about a nation having sovereignty and having troops able to defend its own self, Why is the issue about money important? Is this an issue that has anything to do with money? It is a more fundamental principle that a country should be able to defend itself. Economic concerns should come second. Otherwise, it is simply absurd to be living in such a country.
日本の今の憲法9条っていうのは、これは日米安全保障条約と貼り合わせの1枚のコインなんですよ。憲法9条と日米安保、これが貼り合わせになってる。だから憲法9条5字と守ると、で平和を守れって言ってる日本の平和勢力、リベラル勢力、左翼勢力、これも実は9条を守るんだったら結局日米同盟を認めなきゃいけない。だから同じなんですよ、実は保守と左翼が同じこと言ってるんですよ。米軍に依存せよ、これだけ言ってるんですよ、右から左まで。これがくだらないと思ってるんですよ、私は。
We now have many people in Japan that take the position that they will do everything in their power to protect Article 9 of the Constitution. But when we look very carefully at the Article 9 of the Constitution, we see that it is basically the other side of the coin of the U.S.-Japan Security Pact. In other words, you have on the one hand the U.S.-Japan Security Pact, and on the other side the Article 9. So the people who are belonging to the pacifist wing, or the people who belong to the left wing of the political spectrum, they say we must protect Article 9, we must protect peace. What they're basically saying is that we acknowledge and recognize the importance of the U.S.-Japan Security Pact. In other words, what I'm saying is that the conservatives, the right-wingers and the left-wingers, everyone on the political spectrum is basically saying the same thing. We want to continue to depend on the United States. And I am saying this is all wrong. It's just absurd.
日本は今は、今の日本人は独立心っていうものを失ってしまってますけれども、わしは少数派です、だからけれども、これからは分かりませんよ。わしが多くの日本人を覚醒させて本当の独立国っていうものを築く、そう考えて。今わしまだ元気でしょ、わしもう還暦ですよ、62になりますよ今年ね。安倍首相と一切違い。でもわしは十分エネルギーが充実している。だから日本人を覚醒させようと思っています。
I believe that the number of people in Japan who understand Japan as who do not understand that Japan is not an independent country.I believe that the people, number of people in Japan who wish that Japan could be an independent country are very, very few in number. I know that I am of a very, very small minority, but things may change very much in the future. I believe that I have tremendous energy and vitality, and I think I will be able to inspire and stimulate many, many people to think differently in the future. I think eventually I will be able to rouse enough people so that we can all move and make sure that Japan can be rebuilt again or reborn again as a truly independent nation.You can look at me and you can see that I'm full of energy and vitality. I'm already past 60. I'm 62. There's only a one-year difference between myself and Prime Minister Abe, but I am full of energy. I believe I can accomplish this goal.
Yes, please.
すみません、弁護士 .com の記者の渡辺と申します。ですね、小林先生は先日シールズの若者といろいろ2時間対談をされたという話で、ちょっとホームページにも感想を書かれていましたけれども、一体どういうお話をされたのかと、あと今いろいろこう覚醒させたいということでしたけれども、期待をするかしないかとか、そういったことで話せる範囲で教えていただければと思います。よろしくお願いします。
I'm from Bengoshi or lawyers.com. The other day, it's known that you had a two-hour meeting with a student activist group, which is called SEALDS, S-E-A-L-D-S, and that you met with these young people for about 2 hours, and you referred to your meeting on your homepage a little bit. But can you tell us what you spoke about? And you spoke earlier about wanting to be able to stimulate and inspire more people to seek a more independent Japan. Were you hopeful as a result of your meeting?
例えばね、自民党の議員とか、まあ、保守系の人たちがわざわざあの若者たちをバッシングするんですよね。で、あの人たちはわしとは同じ考えじゃありません。若者はやっぱり未熟なんですよ。で、自分自身の二十歳前後のことを考えてもやっぱり未熟でしたよ。その若者たちが今社会の問題に対して、あるいは国家の問題に対してようやく目覚めたところです。そして特に彼らを持ち上げることも、まあ、やりませんし、でバッシングなんか大人としてはみっともないことだと思っています。
You may know that members of the LDP, Diet members, people from the conservative camp have gone out. Some people have gone out of their way to bash these young people. To be very forthright, these young people that I met, they do not share exactly my way of thinking about world events or about politics. In fact, when I met with them, my first impression was that they are immature. But then when I look back to when I was their age, around 20, I myself was also immature. But these are young people who have suddenly and for the first time become aware, have opened their eyes to what is happening in the world around them and what is happening on the political stage and what is happening to their country. So I have no intention of trying to somehow, you know, raise their reputation. But at the same time, I believe that it is shameful for grown adults to bash these young people.
昔ね、わしよりちょっと上の世代、団塊の世代って言って一番人口が多い世代なんですけど、その世代の人たちが若者だった頃、戦争を知らない子どもたちっていう歌が大ヒットしたんですね。この戦争を知らない子どもたち、自分たちは戦後生まれで戦争を知らない子どもたちだと、これが未来を作るんだって言ってすごく誇らしげに歌ってたんですよ。で、それを戦争を知っているわしの両親とかは、まあ、苦々しく見ていたんですね。ところがですよ、その団塊の世代、戦争を知らない子どもたちって言ってそれを誇らしく歌っていた若者たちは、今保守系の雑誌ばっかり読んで中国と韓国のバッシングばっかりやってます。全くみっともない。
When I look back to my young age, I remember that the generation slightly older than myself, these are the people who belong to the baby boom generation. They are the most numerous in terms of numbers of people. When they were young, I remember that there was a song that was very, very popular, and the title of the song was Young People Who Do Not Know War. In other words, it was a song about young people who were born after the war, who had no knowledge or experience of battles, but who for them had the responsibility and the hope of building a bright new world. I remember that their parents, my parents, the people of that generation who had seen the difficulties and horrible aspects of war, looked upon the people, the young people singing this song with great pride and great joy, and they kind of laughed rather in reserve. In other words, they wondered if they were going to be all right. These people, these young people who sang this song about creating a bright new future, you know, one without war, all of their hopes and optimism, now these people are old, and what they do is they read only very conservative magazines. They spend all their time bashing China, bashing South Korea. I think it is a truly shameful state of affairs.
Yes, you want to ask some? Yeah, since that you talk about war in the Middle East, I invite Mr. Ambassador of Bahrain to ask question. Thank you.
Khalil Hassan, I enjoyed your presentation. The world is changing. All the rules you have in Japan is related to the 20th century, and we are moving to the 21st century. Okay? And the United States is changing. More than 85% of the United States public, they don't want to be involved in any war outside their country. They don't want to be involved with other people's wars. And this is very obvious just now in the Middle East. Okay? Now, if this really happened to Japan, how Japan going to deal with the situation? Is my question clear?
はい、バーリン国の大使でございます。素晴らしいお話ありがとうございます。世界はどんどん変わりつつあるわけでございます。日本を見ましても今までのルールというものは20世紀のために作られたルールでございますが、もうどんどん21世紀にルールも変わってきているわけでございます。そして日本だけではなく米国そのものも変わりつつあるわけでございます。まあ、いろんな世論調査があるんですが、その 85% の人々は海外米国以外での戦争には関わりたくない、関係したくないというような、調査結果も出ているわけでございます。まあ、私は中東出身ですので、そういうようなその考え方 の影響というのは直に受けているわけでございます。でもこのようにその、米国がそういうような考えになってくるということになりますと、日本はそれにどうやって対応するんでございましょうか。I'm sorry, if you're saying that the United States doesn't want to be involved in outside wars, what will Japan do in terms of
Now, the situation is very clear now in the Middle East. The United States preventing to be involved in any direct war. Okay? Okay? Now, this might one day happen to Japan. Because if the American people don't want war outside, any government cannot push for a war.
So Japanese people might not want to go and fight outside. Is that what you're saying? I just wanted to make sure I understood the question, that there may come a day when Japanese people will also not want to be involved in outside wars?
No. Now, no? Japan is depending on U.S.To protect it.
Oh, I understand. Thank you. Sorry. そうですね。ごめんなさい。いずれその米国はもっと海外のその戦争に巻き込まれたくないっていう話にどんどん、まあ、なっていくであれば、まあ、今日本は米国に頼ってるわけでございますね。まあ、しかしその海外での戦争に巻き込まれたくない、関係したくないということに本当になってしまったら、日本はどうすればどう対応するんでございますでしょうか。
まずですね。アメリカはベトナム戦争の後もしばらくは国内にしか関心を向かないようになったんですね。それがしばらく経つとやっぱりアフガン、イラク戦争っていう形で外にナショナリズムをぶつけていくってことになってしまうんですね。で、アメリカが世界の警察官であるのならば、やはり侵略戦争をやって、で今の中東情勢のように混乱させっぱなしじゃダメです。しかも人命に対する差別があるんですね。アラブの人たちの人命は軽いんですよ。アメリカにとってみたら何十万人殺してもいいと思ってるんですよ。こういう状態が良くない。果たしてその警察であり得るかどうか、アメリカが。十分これは警戒しないといけない。で、日本っていうのは、そこまで中東までのトークっていうふうに言うと、やはり戦争という形で関わってはダメです。わしが考えるのはですね、例えば自衛隊を二分割してしまうんです。で一つは平和貢献の部隊にして、そしてそれは本当に戦争とか戦いには関係なくどのように協力できるのか、現地の人たちが何を望んでいるのかっていう形で関わらないといけません。例えばイラクの後にサマーに行きました、自衛隊が。けどあれはアメリカに対する、まあ、一応参加したからっていうね、この言い訳のためだけに言ってるんですよ。だから今現在どうなってるかって言ったら、結局インフラをいくらやったって、インフラ整備には後の維持が必要ですからね、維持費が。そう、維持はできないから元に戻っちゃうわけですね。ボロボロになってしまうわけです。 で、あそこに重機を置いてきてるんだけど、そう、重機を使いこなせる人間がサマーにいないから埃かぶってしまってるわけです。で、そういう貢献の仕方じゃやっぱりダメなんだな。本当にイラク復興っていう理念が日本の中にあったかどうかないんですよ。やはり私、自衛隊軍隊として出ていくっていうことは非常に誤解を受けるっていうのがあるから、平和貢献の部隊は別に作った方がいいんじゃないかなっていうふうに考えてます。
I believe that, first of all, I understand what you're saying, that, Japanese, that U.S. public opinion right now, is very much inward-looking. We saw a similar situation after the Vietnam War, after the bitter experiences for the United States. The United States concentrated on domestic policies for a very long time. But after a time, nationalism rises again, and people venture outside, and the United States found itself in Afghanistan, in Iraq, taking part in wars. I guess it's a fundamental question if whether or not the United States will continue in the future to act as the world's policeman. In other words, I believe very strongly that if the United States is going to be involved in wars in the future, and I think it will be involved in wars of aggression in the future, then at least what we can say is that it should not leave the country in which it has waged war in a state of utter confusion. For example, if we look at the situation in the Middle East, that kind of situation is terrible to behold. I also think that there is racial discrimination or ethnic discrimination. The value of one American life compared to the value of one Arab life, obviously the scales are not balanced. There is a thinking on the U.S. side that it is all right for many tens of thousands of Arab people to perish, that American lives are more important or more valuable. Again, it goes back to this question of whether or not the United States truly can continue to operate as the world's policeman. As far as the Middle East situation, one of the things that I feel very strongly about is that Japan should not be involved in that kind of a situation to begin with. And if it is involved in any way in a situation in a place so far away, it should be involved in a very different way. I have a fundamental way of thinking about the self-defense forces. I think that perhaps it should be split into two divisions or split into two groups, and one would be what we would consider the regular military, and the other would be a special organization that would be called Peace Contribution Troops. And this Peace Contribution Troops would not actually be engaged in battle or conflicts, in wars. They would only offer cooperation to the local people, but they would offer cooperation after discussions, close discussions with the local people to understand and what it is that they really want. The reason I say that is because after the Iraq War, you may remember that self-defense forces troops went to Samoa to help rebuild the infrastructure there. It was supposed to be a contribution that they were going to make toward reconstruction. However, when we see what they did, it seems now in retrospect that the self-defense forces did their work, they made their presence known just in order to satisfy world opinion, especially U.S. opinion, that they had indeed made a physical contribution to things. But the kind of things that they did, they built infrastructure, was that truly what the people there needed? The reason I ask this is that it's one thing to build infrastructure, it's another thing to be able to maintain it. And there was not enough training or advice or guidance given so that people could maintain their infrastructure. There was a lot of heavy machinery that was transported there. However, people there do not know how to operate it, so all of that heavy machinery is there rusting and gathering dust. In other words, did Japan, the Japanese government, really think in advance about truly trying to help the people of Samoa, or was it just that they were making a show of things? I understand that sometimes when I talk about Japan having not the self-defense forces but a military, that can invite misunderstanding. So I think there should be another group that should be just only contributing in a peaceful way.
外交に対するタフネスさってのはいりますよね。結局そのタリバンとだってですよ、散々戦争して、で結局はタリバンと外交交渉で決着をつけようかって話になるわけです。アメリカだってだったら最初からやれよとって話になりますし、あるいは日中中間線のガス田開発の問題もそうですよね。あるいは日本と中国の間で共同経営するっていう合意が取られてたはずなのに、そこから先の外交交渉が進まないからどんどん増えていってしまう。で最後は武力に頼らなければいけないということになる。 外交の力、そのタフネスさっていうのがもう必要にやらなければならない。それしか結局はその世界を平和に安定的に持っていく方法ってやっぱり ないんですね。だからロシアなんかだってそうですよね。ウクライナに侵攻してますけれども、あれも先に実行支配してしまったらどうにもならないという形になりますけど、やはり世界中がどこもがやっぱり今の国際法自体を犯す武力で変更するということは良くないということをちゃんと自国の人たちに伝えてほしいですね。報道関係者の人たちがで、なるべくこれ外交交渉に徹底的に持ち込む必要にあるっていうタフネスさがもうそれしかないんですから。
And I also believe that what is truly necessary is to have diplomatic powers and to be able to be tough negotiators in the world of diplomacy. I say this because in the end, it is only diplomacy that will be able to resolve various conflicts. After all, the United States fought bitterly with the Taliban, but at the end, they had to resort to negotiations, diplomacy, in order to try to reach some kind of a truce. If that was going to be the conclusion, then why did they wage war in the first place? Why didn't they start by negotiating?We see a similar situation occurring between Japan and China. Yes, we're fighting about the quarreling about the gas fields, drilling work that is going on. There was already in place a joint agreement to jointly manage the operation and digging for oil and natural resources around this area. However, once that agreement was reached, further diplomatic efforts basically ceased. And as a result, tensions have risen, and now people are thinking about resorting to force.In the final analysis, again, it's only diplomacy that will be able to ensure that we will have a stable and peaceful future. We see that things have gone wrong in other areas of the world. We see what Russia has done with the Ukraine. We see that diplomacy is truly the only key, even though in that case, we already had a situation where they tried to take de facto control of a territory before negotiations began. But in the end, I think diplomacy must be taught to all peoples of the world as being the only solution the media educators should convey to the people of their countries that international law must be respected, that changing the status quo by use of military force is unacceptable. We have to have diplomacy and we have to have tough negotiators.
ここに世界中の報道機関の人が集まっておられるので具体的な方法論として一つ言いたいんですけれども、国際連合を戦勝国体制にしておくっていうのをそろそろやめませんかね。こう常任理事国を今の戦勝国だけで独占しているっていう状態、これでは国際社会良くなりませんよ。だから今の国連の在り方っていうものを変えようという声をそれぞれの国からこう呼び起こしてくれませんかね。そうしなければこれどうにもならないですよ。アメリカの側が賛成って言っても中国やロシアが必ず拒否権発動するとかっていうやり方では良くならないでしょう。国連改革っていうのが一番必要ですね。具体的な方法としてはね、本当に平和を国際社会を平和にしたいって思ってるのならね、それとも戦勝国だけでこの世界の枠組みを独占したいっていうふうに思ってるのなら結局はダメなんですけれどもね。
Since media from various countries throughout the world are here today, I would like to make one specific proposal. I believe one specific way in which we can truly better the situation in the world, and that is that we must change, I believe, the system of the makeup or the composition of the United Nations. In other words, the United Nations was created in a way that basically ensures that the victorious nations in World War II basically monopolize all authority and all power.In other words, the fact that the permanent members of the Security Council are composed of the former victorious nations means that eventually the international community cannot be satisfied. They cannot be happy with this. The United Nations should be changed. The United Nations must be reformed. And it is not only voices like such as myself that must be raised, but I beg all of you to try to encourage voices from all over the world to be raised about reforming the United Nations. the way things stand, even if the United States agrees to something, Russia or China will always exercise its veto power, and nothing will be ever moved forward. United Nations reform is the most pressing issue of the day if we truly want international peace in the world. If, however, the opposite is true, that we want to continue with this current system where the victorious nations in the past war basically monopolize all authority and power in the world, then I can understand that no one wants reform. But if we truly want peace, then we must reform the United Nations.
Thank you very much. There's very last question, but please make it short, please. Okay.
国民新聞論説委員元ですけども、藤田博之と申します。首脳談話のこともあるんで確認の意味で お伺いしたい。大東亜戦争は侵略戦争だったと思いですか。今さっきの話だとまるで侵略戦争だったというふうにこう言われているような印象を受けました。
Aside from the Kukmin newspaper, I want to ask just confirmation in regard to what is called the Great East Asian War, the past war. Do you think this was a war of aggression? Listening to your past comments, I do get that impression. I just want to confirm your thoughts.
安倍首相がね、アメリカの議会で日本のアメリカとの出会いは民主主義との遭遇だったと演説しました。でそうするとアメリカの議会がこう拍手していましたね。あれは嘘です。日本とアメリカの出会いは訪韓外交、ペリー提督がやってきて大砲ぶっ放しながら不平等条約を結んだのです。そこから日本は近代国家になり帝国主義の中に入っていかなければいけない状態になりました。
So you may remember that in spring of this year, Prime Minister Abe gave a speech in front of the U.S. Congress, and he said something to the effect that Japan and the United States first came together, their first meeting was as to democratic nations or through democracy. And when he made this remark, people in Congress clapped. However, that was a true lie. When you think about how Japan and the United States first came together, it was through what is called gunboat diplomacy. In other words, Commodore Perry came into Japan and basically forced on Japan one of the unequal treaties that were followed by other unequal treaties by other nations. Japan under this pressure was forced to modernize quickly, and as it found itself in the age of empires, it had no choice but to also try to become an empire.
戦争をして植民地を持つ、これをやらないと一流国として認められないんです。だから不平等条約を解消できないんです。当時はそういう時代だったんですよ。
In other words, it was a time when a nation could not be recognized as a first-class nation unless it waged war and made colonies for itself. In other words, unless you had that kind of standing, you could not resolve or reform or revise these unequal treaties. That's the situation that Japan found itself in that era.
日本が開国したのはチャイナがすでに侵略されて虫食い状態になっていたからなんですね。それを恐怖したんです。欧米列強を恐怖したんです。それで帝国主義に入っていき、日清戦争、日露戦争勝ってしまいました。ここから日本のおごりが出てくるんです。まず
So when Japan was opened first to the world, China already had been completely dominated and invaded through wars of aggression. It had been completely carved up by the great powers of the world. Japan felt a tremendous terror that it was next on the list to be carved up and become colonized. So it felt that it had to follow the example of other empires. It started the Sino-Japanese War. It also started the was found itself in the Russo-Japanese War, and by fortuitous circumstances, that it won both of these wars, and that was the point at which Japan began to become full of itself, began to feel boastful.
日本もだから日清日露に勝った軍部に日本国民全員期待してしまいました。それでもう政治の歯止めが効かなくなってしまった。そして最後に誰もアメリカと戦いたくなかったのに戦わなければいけなくなってしまった。でこれはもう日本の開国以来の運命なんですよ。もう大日本大東亜戦争というのはアメリカに交換外交で強引に開国され、帝国主義の中に放り出され、そこで生き抜いた結果またアメリカと戦って敗戦する。ここまでが一つの大東亜戦争で、これはもう運命だと私は思っています。
I believe that Japan, because it found itself the victor in the Sino-Japanese War and the Russian-Japanese War, the people of Japan found itself respecting, honoring, admiring its military leaders. As a result, the Japanese people had tremendous expectations of these military leaders. But because these military leaders had gained so much power and influence, there were no political controls or checks on their power anymore.As a result of all of this, Japan found itself in a situation where no one in the country wanted to fight the United States. They found themselves in a situation where Japan had no choice but to fight the United States. So again, I go back to history, to the opening of Japan to the world. Japan did not want to open itself up. Japan wanted to remain isolated and on its own. Yet from the point of in time when Commodore Perry forced Japan at gunpoint to open up its borders, I think Japan was destined eventually to find itselfEmbroiled in this great war and to fight the United States. In other words, I believe when you look at this great East Asia war, this was a natural progression from gunboat diplomacy, being forced to open up, being thrown into the age of empires, and finding oneself, fighting Japan, having to fight the United States all over again.
自らの運命を否定するというような考えに私は立ちません。そういう意味では大東亜戦争肯定論です。
So I think that when one is destined to follow a particular path, then I think I'm not a kind of person who rails against a destiny. In that sense, in other words, I believe that we were destined to follow that path. And as a result, although I don't think it's necessarily a good path, I feel I can be classified as one who supports or thinks positively about the Great War because we were destined to do so, and you cannot fight destiny.
All right.
あ、侵略戦争でしたかどうかというのが質問だったのでございますが、それに対してはお答えはいかがでございますでしょうか。
どこの時点？
At what point in time?
それがわからないんですよ。
It has,
シナに入った行ったことはこれは侵略戦争です。
As I mentioned earlier, at the point when in time when Japan invaded China, yes, when we entered China, that was a war of aggression.
Thank you very much. This is very great. We will have great quotes today from your presentation. And I would like to make kind of breaking news here to show what he wrote on our sign book. He's a cartoonist, our guest, but usually we heard from him. We didn't see anything he wrote. He played, so he signed this very nice picture of himself on our...guest book. I don't know why he's not smiling here, but I think from his statements we know the answer about that. And for that we would like to give you one year honorary membership. Please come to our club next time, and please draw your ideas into cartoons so we can publish them. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming and have a nice evening.